Thank you very much. The departure of the Jews from Syria and Lebanon was a multi-phase and ongoing process which can be divided into five phases. Jews began emigrating from Syria already in the last third of the 19th century, before the onset of the political conflict between the ambitions of the Zionist and Arab nationalist movements. Jews at the time joined the stream of Christian and Muslim emigrants seeking their fortunes overseas in the New World. The second phase of immigration began following the announcement of the 1909 Ottoman draft law, while the third phase began after the First World War and continued until Syria's independence. The fourth phase continued until the 1990s, while the fifth and the last phase began in 1992 and continued for a short while until the last of the Jews had departed Syria and Lebanon. The first phase. In the second half of the 19th century, about 20,000 Jews lived in Syria alongside the Muslim majority population that numbered about 250,000. Following the Egyptian conquest of Syria, 1831 to 1840, the frequent contact that developed between the government center in Egypt and Syria led to immigration, especially to Egypt. Steamships also contributed their part to the shrinking of the Mediterranean Sea, as they made possible the safe, quick, and relatively cheap passage of goods and people from country to country. This phenomenon began to intensify in the late 1870s, and by the mid of the 1880s, a mass movement had developed throughout all of Syria. This emigration was comprised especially of religious minorities, indicative of underlying religious ethnic motivations. At the same time, economic factors seem to have had a predominant impact on the Syrian Jewish emigration. The Syrian economy was devastated by the opening of the Suez Canal. The opening of markets and their exposure to cheap consumer goods imported from Europe made existing industries obsolete. Emigration that had begun as a trickle in the mid-1880s became a powerful current by the end of the 1890s. This was the height of the process whereby Jews transitioned from fatalistic acceptance of their fate in a Middle Eastern Muslim society to taking the radical proactive step of emigrating to the West in search of a better future. This emigration had far-reaching social impact on the local communities. Without the educated and talented young people who could have led them towards progress and modernization, the communities instead began to decline. Over and beyond the economic, political, religious, and cultural motivations for immigrating, other facilitating factors deserve recognition. Thus, for example, the advice and assistance offered by the early immigrants to their relatives and the stories of wealth in the West and the ease with which it could be achieved became one of the strongest forces encouraging emigration. The power of the pen, that is, of the immigrant's letter to their families, became an even more powerful force encouraging emigration than the sword of the oppressor, that is, of religious political discrimination. The development of the Beirut Jewish community in the second half of the 19th century was a byproduct of this process of emigration. The Beirut seaport became the immigrants' gateway to the New World. Beirut's accelerated economic development also turned it into an attractive destination, and consequently, a local community began to grow. Beirut became both the political and administrative center of the independent autonomous district established in 1861. From that time onward, it registered a constant increase in the number of its Jews. For many years, Beirut attracted Jews not only from the Middle East, but also from Europe. This phenomenon was extraordinary relative to the demographic developments in Jewish communities in other Arab countries, as the trend of growth continued even after the founding of the State of Israel. The second phase. The Young Turk Revolution, which sought to actualize the Ottoman constitution that promised equal rights and obligation for every citizen, took place in the summer of 1908. It was in this context that the parliament legislated in August 1909 the general obligatory draft law, which for the first time applied to non-Muslims. Despite the Jews' basic loyalty to the government, they nonetheless perceived the draft law as a threat, for it was known that draftees would be cut off from their families for many years and would not be able and would be unable to maintain a Jewish way of life. This perception, together with a general sense of disappointment from unfulfilled promises of equality, combined with the young people's reluctance to lose their best years in the ranks of the army and their desire to take advantage of the plentiful possibilities and economic opportunities that awaited them overseas. This lack of desire to enlist was not found only among the Jews, but also among Muslim and Christians. Over the course of the first decade of the 20th century, between 1,500 to 2,000 young Jews emigrated from Damascus. Third phase. Some of the Jews exiled from the land of Israel during the First World War arrived in Damascus, thereby exposing the local community to Zionism. These Jews, through their educational activity, sought to instill in Damascus Jewry the Hebrew language and the idea of Jewish nationalism. Zionist activity throughout the years of the French Mandate in Syria and Lebanon focused on the Hebrew schools and the Zionist youth movements. Throughout this period, emigration continued to be a predominant phenomenon in the lives of the Jews in Syria. The Beirut community continued to absorb immigrants. It appears that between 1932 to 1944, over 1,500 Jews emigrated from Syria to Lebanon. During the 1920s, the French Mandate authorities did little to obstruct the departure of Jews overseas or to the land of Israel. During this same period, on the other hand, the United States began to limit the number of immigrants' visas, so emigrants turned instead towards South America and the land of Israel. The proximity of the land of Israel to Syria made it an easier destination, and Zionist activity in the communities led to an increase in the number of immigrants who chose to go there. However, the rate of emigration decreased during these same years due to improvement in Jewish life under the French Mandate. Emigration accelerated once again in the first half of the 1930s, due both to economic decline in Syria and Lebanon and to increasing anti-Zionist feelings among the Arab population, for whom Zionist Jewish nationalism clashed with Arab nationalist ambitions. The years of the Second World War were characterized by a significant increase in emigrants who chose the land of Israel as their destination, as their routes overseas were dangerous or unpassable. Free France's renewed control over Syria and Lebanon once again made possible their connection to the land of Israel. These years were also characterized by increasing influence of Nazi propaganda in Syria and Lebanon. The Jews' awakening sense of security, alongside a desire to meet the need created in the land of Israel for working hands and to strengthen the political status of the Yishuv leadership, led to expansion of illegal immigration activity from Syria and Lebanon. Between 1942 to 1947, 5,286 Jews immigrated to Israel from Syria and Lebanon. This number includes the immigration in 1945 of 1,350 children and youth in the context of Aliyat Elef, the immigration of the thousand. These children were smuggled to Israel with their parents' consent. Parental consent was given mostly because of internal political turmoil in Syria prior to the removal of the French in May 1945 and the perception that the Jews had been collaborators with the foreign rule. Fourth phase. Following the Second World War, Jewish institutions in Palestine turned their efforts to saving the remnants of European Jewry. Nonetheless, and despite British closure of the borders, increasing numbers of Jewish immigrants continued to penetrate them. More than 1,000 Jews immigrated illegally on their own during 1946 to 1947. A turning point in the flow of immigration came on November 29, 1947, when the United Nations General Assembly's announcement of the establishment of Jewish and Arab states in the land of Israel put a temporary halt to illegal immigration from Syria and Lebanon. From that point on, Syrian Jews became hostages who were forbidden to leave. Many restraints that became increasingly severe over the years were placed upon them. Various Jewish organizations began to assist Syrian Jewry by transferring money and obtaining visas for entry to the United States. In parallel, since the establishment of the State of Israel, Syrian Jews have continually attempted to immigrate to it illegally. Immigration efforts focused primarily on crossing the Lebanese border, which was less guarded than the Israel-Syrian border. Immigration from Syria was recognized by the State of Israel at that time as rescue immigration that was not subject to restrictions of immigration quotas. Hundreds of Jews were smuggled from Syria to Lebanon and from there overland or within overland to within Israel's borders. An alternative route was by sea from the ports of Beirut, Tyre, and Sidon to Israel Navy ships. Following secret agreements between Israel and Turkey, another route was opened on the Syrian-Turkish border. Between 1955 to 1962, about 2,500 Syrian Jews reached the State of Israel. In the years following the Six-Day War, immigration from Syria increased considerably. Between 1967 to 1970, worsening of living conditions and an intensified identification with the State of Israel led to the immigration of 2,264 Jews who came to Israel via numerous different routes. At the same time, the Six-Day War was a turning point in the status and feelings of Jews in Lebanon, who at time numbered about 6,000. Incidents of violence toward them increased, creating a real threat to the future existence of Jewish life in Lebanon. Consequently, emigration of Lebanese Jews accelerated. By the early 1970s, only 2,000 Jews remained. Lebanon's deteriorating internal political situation led also to a worsening economic situation, which further accelerated emigration. Thus, between 1971 to 1982, only a few hundred members of the Beirut Jewish community remained. Because of the 1975 to 1977 civil war, less than 500 Jews remained in Beirut. The strengthening of the Shiite Hezbollah organization further darkened the lives of the Jews. In mid-1985, only about 100 Jews remained in Lebanon, and in 1999, only about 60 remained, living mostly in Christian areas of the city and incapable of maintaining any communal life. In November 1970, Hafez al-Assad took over the Syrian government. As a rule to stop the flow of Jewish escape, the authorities made conditions for the Jews worse. Various Israeli and international organizations acted throughout the years to improve the situation of Syrian Jews, but to no avail. In November 1975, the National Committee of the Jews of Arab Countries began operating in Canada under the leadership of Judy Feldkar, devoting itself especially to saving Syria's Jews. At first, Jews were taken out who had exceptional problems. Over time, exit of single Jewish women and even entire families was purchased. Over the years, Mrs. Feldkar assisted in bringing out tens of families and many single young women by, among other means, marrying them with single Jewish men in Canada and the United States. International pressure on Syria to permit them to exit freely reached its height in 1977 with al-Assad's promise to the United States President Jimmy Carter that he would permit Jewish women to leave Syria in order to marry. In the end, however, he allowed only 14 women to leave. The fifth, the final exit. Changes in the international balance of power, such as the disappearance of the Soviet Union and the first Gulf War, created new opportunities to convince Hafez al-Assad to allow Syria's Jews to leave his country. International pressure bore fruit in the mid-April 1992. Al-Assad announced that he would permit Syria's Jews to exit freely. At the time, there were about 1,400 Jews in Damascus, 400 in Aleppo, and about 100 in Qamishli. Permission for the Jews to leave was accompanied by restrictions that apply to every citizen wanting to leave Syria for purposes of tourism, including, among other things, prohibition against taking out property and currency beyond an amount determined by law. They were, of course, also prohibited from visiting Israel, the enemy Zionist state. In the first wave, in the end of 1992, about 2,800 Jews left Syria for the United States. Emigration was again prohibited in the end of that year, but was allowed once again following a meeting in January 1994 between al-Assad and the United States President Bill Clinton. This time, Jews were permitted to take out their property. By mid-1994, no Jews were left in Aleppo and Qamishli. In total, since their departure was allowed, more than 4,000 Jews left. This was the end of the struggle for Syrian Jews and of the long and ongoing process of emigration that began in the second half of the 19th century and concluded on the brink of the 21st century with the departure of the last of the Jews of Syria and Lebanon. Thank you very much.